Hello, everybody. I'm Charlie Tolhurst, and welcome to Charlie Tolhurst Show for tonight, the 11th of September, live on YouTube. And yes, it's been an interesting week. The last couple of days have been emotional. I'm joined by Labour Party supporter Zach Chambers, trying to all the week's news. Hello, Zach.
Hi, Charlie. Hello, mate.
Now, just to let you know, guys, on the show in a minute, there will be a 2-minute silence being held in memory of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, who died peacefully at Balmoral on Thursday. And I have the statement here from the royal family, which we're going to read out to you right now, very quickly. And I want to mention exactly what the royal family have said. They put out a statement to say Her Majesty died peacefully at Balmoral on Thursday. Following further evaluation this morning, the Queen's doctors are concerned for Her Majesty's health. That was before that she remained under medical supervision at Balmoral. It was announced, though, that the press release came out that she died. And King Charles III said, "The death of my beloved mother, Her Majesty the Queen, is a moment of the greatest sadness for me and all my members of my family. We mourn profoundly the passing of a cherished sovereign and a much-loved mother. I know her loss will be deeply felt throughout the country, the realms and the Commonwealth, and by countless people around the world. During this period of mourning and change, my family and I will be comforted and sustained by our knowledge of the respect and deep affection in which the Queen was so widely held." I'm going to bring you up this little statement now from the King, King Charles III, who is now going to be succeeding the Queen on the throne of the country. There is a statement there, guys, that is now available on the royal.co.uk website there as well. So, Zach, a huge loss for the country. What is your tribute to Queen Elizabeth, Her Majesty the Second, after her shock passing on Thursday?
Well, first of all, Charlie, what a week it's been. I have to say, it still feels really strange knowing that the person that we've known for so many years, I know we're quite young, but the person we've known since we were born that has ruled over us is no longer ruling over us. And it feels strange. And in some ways, despite the fact that, she's 96, that it feels like she's gone too soon. I mean, a few months ago, we were celebrating her Jubilee, Platinum Jubilee, hoping for a few more years on that throne. And I just feel, you know, it feels too soon. Even though she's 96, it feels too soon. It just feels, whoa, like this has happened. But my gosh, I have to admit, it has been like emotional for a lot of people because they've lived and been ruled under this queen. And they've loved her. Everything, no matter through hell or high water, they've always turned to one person for comfort. And that is the Queen. And in times of hell, she was the person that, you know, brought us all together, whether we agreed on things or whether we disagreed on things. And she's just a lovely human being. She was the most wonderful human being you could ever get. And she did so much service for this country and for the Commonwealth. This is 1959. That still feels... It feels a long time ago, but it still feels relevant today. I mean, it still gets to me that, it's not her. There's something just like there's something weird in the atmosphere without her. There's something missing, and I just feel like, everything without her is not with us. Yeah, we have to move on eventually, but it's going to feel strange. It's it does feel strange. I mean, when the news came Thursday, it took some time to get used to it. It was a very sad moment. But obviously, given all the statements that come out, she's been a beloved woman, a beloved role model for everybody, and just a lovely human being. And the world will not be the same without her. I'm not an emotional guy. I must admit, I'm not an emotional guy. I didn't cry. I'll be honest. I didn't cry. But I nearly did get emotional. You know, I went to bed like, I mean, it was the first day that she was pronounced dead on the Thursday. And I went to bed and I just read all the posts about it. And I nearly cried because, you know, it just tells me how much of a global role model she was. And I nearly met her in person once. I'll tell you something that will give me a memory. I nearly met her in person once. I was a little kid then. I didn't quite. I kicked up the day that I was supposed to. She came to my local town. And I was a little kid then. And I kicked up a fuss because I thought I already saw her. So I went home early. It turns out she was just having a lunch. But so I never actually got to see her, but I nearly did see her once. Yeah, I mean, she obviously used to come around to Essex and visit the Tiptree Jam Factory. She was visited that once, and I've been to the Jam Factory where the Queen's visited before. It's a lovely place. But this think about this, Charlie. This was on the Tuesday, 2 days before her death.
Yeah, this was when Liz Truss was succeeded Boris Johnson as Prime Minister.
This is normally on a normal week like this, Charlie, we'd be talking about Liz Truss. Okay. On a normal week, we'd be talking about her and the fact that she's been sworn in as new Prime Minister, and then we would have been discussing cost of living intervention. But we're all focused on the Queen for obvious reasons why, but This is 2 days before her death, right? Okay.
This was the last photo that they managed to find of her.
This is the last ever photos of her. She looked happy. She looked smiley. Obviously, yeah, okay. She had mobility issues. We all knew about that. She had problems moving, and it was very open. Very open. It's clear to see that she had problems moving. But look at her. She looks like her usual cheery self. She's very happy to be greeted by Liz Truss is very happy to be greeted by the new Queen. She's happy. The Queen's very happy to be greeted by Liz Truss. This is her doing a constitutional duty in Balmoral. I mean, yes, they're all normally everyone gets sworn in Buckingham Palace, but obviously because of her mobility issue, she got sworn in. You know, Liz Truss to go all the way up to Balmoral to be sworn in. But yeah, she looked absolutely fine. Some say she looked a bit pale. I can't really tell too much, but she looked wonderful. She really did. She looked wonderful, and she looked happy. She looked a pleasure to be greeted, to have another visitor. And it suggests to me that something clearly deteriorated in her the day after, because obviously the Privy Council meeting that they were supposed to have online, which is done over Zoom, she couldn't even do that. I didn't think much about it at the time because I thought, oh well, it's just one of another duties that she can't do. And then it was obviously the Thursday when everyone in the Commons started looking grim for whatever reason during the cost of living debate. There were all these notes that are passed around between Deans and Zahari, the Prime Minister at the time, the Deputy Prime Minister, the leaders of the opposition. They've all been whisked out the chamber to be told something. And then we found out what it was. The thing that made me start and get me concerned was when all the family were summoned to Balmoral. Now, when I knew the family got summoned to Balmoral, I knew this was something really serious, because if the Queen was just a little bit ill, but not seriously ill, those family wouldn't have been summoned. The fact that William, Kate, even Harry and, you know, Charles were all summoned up, suggested to me that there was something really worrying going on. And we were just waiting, holding our breath. And then the announcement came at 6:30. And yeah. Oh. it was really something hearing the national anthem after on like I was watching Sky at the time. The BBC will obviously had to interrupt all their programming, but I was watching on Sky and you just couldn't believe it. You couldn't believe it. But we really have lost the soul of the nation, the world, the Commonwealth. And now we're 3 days into a new era now of King Charles. I mean, good luck to him. I think at the moment, he's been a good role model. He is being a good role model at the moment. And I expect he'll continue to be a good role model and follow in the footsteps of his mother very quickly. Because he's got big shoes to step in. And I think so far, he's doing well. It must be really tough for him, given that he lost, you know, given God, he lost someone close to him. But he's stepping up his responsibilities. And I have to say, if you look at today, the events of the last few days, not involved, but all the practice and the operations that have been done, with all this history that we've never seen before, Charlie, since 1952, all on our screens, all the bands practicing, all the military salutes, they've been executed so well that they've actually been prepared for this moment. And it's just amazing how well they've all done, you know, watching all the displays on television. But yeah, it was obviously quite surreal today to watch the coffin go by Edinburgh, then Dundee, Aberdeenshire. And the fact is that this time, probably not this Monday, but next Monday, we were having a funeral. The world is a strange place. It's a strange place at the moment, Charlie.
I have to say, Zach, it's my thoughts are with the royal family at the moment. And obviously, to everyone who was a close aide to the Queen, it's just a horrible spectacle to hear your beloved Queen, your beloved Majesty, the ruler of the Commonwealth, the ruler of this country, no longer hear it. I think I kind of knew it when the BBC were wearing the black, all black suits and the black ties, and I kind of knew what was coming, and it came at 6:30, the announcement that Her Majesty had passed away at the age of 96. It was a pretty emotional day. And right now, guys, on my show, we're going to take a brief couple of minutes silence in honour of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth. The last post, which was used at the Remembrance Day, the Armistice silence, will be played now on my show in memory of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, in which we will get a photograph up of her now, which we'll be using to dedicate the silence to her right now. This is the photo we will be using. Thank you, guys, and we'll see you in a brief minute. Please join in the silence, guys, wherever you are from home. This is the last post silence for Queen Elizabeth II. Enjoy. thank you there, guys. A huge thank you to everybody that took part there in the brief little silence in memory there of Queen Elizabeth II, Her Majesty the Queen, who died on Thursday at the age of 96. Our tributes here on the Charlie Tolhurst Show are with Her Majesty. And also, we are proud to announce and wish good luck King Charles III on his new reign as King of England. His coronation will be coming up in about 6 months' time. And he's now the new king to be here in the UK. Of course, the funeral will take place on the 19th of September. That will also be a bank holiday as well, in which the UK will take part in the funeral at 11 o'clock. So silences will be held across the country in memory of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. So that's that now, guys. We're going to move on and talk about the general news now of the show. I'm going to hit straight over to Liz Truss now and talk about, well, we're going to talk about Liz Truss's first week in Parliament. We're also going to go through Liz Truss's new cabinet as well, because there's been lots of changes in the cabinet that me and Zach are going to go over. So Liz Truss replacing Boris Johnson now as Prime Minister, the next Prime Minister of the UK, winning against Rishi Sunak in a leadership contest. The new cabinet now has been announced. And who is in Liz Truss's cabinet? We have a bunch of names up here. We're going to share you through the screen. So Liz Truss will be the Prime Minister. We also have appointments across the board. Therese Coffey will go to Deputy Prime Minister and Health Secretary, Kwasi Kwarteng, Chancellor, and James Cleverly, who is the MP for Braintree, taking the role as Foreign Secretary. And Zach, plenty of MPs changing, but Ben Wallace staying as Defence Secretary.
Yeah, I have to say, Charlie, not a surprise that Ben Wallace is staying as Defence Secretary. He has excelled, one of the very few cabinet members in the Johnson cabinet that actually has really excelled in that role. I mean, he steered us through the war in Ukraine, obviously the British response to it, and he's done very well. So it's not really surprising that he's staying on as Defence Secretary as well. Let's go through the others as well, because obviously when I look at this cabinet, I look at it as basically Liz Truss's best friends, basically in the top jobs, really. If you look at what Liz Truss's approach on this is, that she's basically put a bunch of loyalists right next to her, so that if any decisions are need to be made, they can all support her in decisions. And not really surprising, to be fair. So Therese Coffey has been named Deputy Prime Minister. She's another previous Norfolk MP as well. Very close to Liz Truss's constituency. She's been made Health Secretary. She's also the number two in line because she's the Deputy Prime Minister. So she will be deputising for her in Prime Minister's questions, obviously, so as well, whenever she takes place. Kwasi Kwarteng. This is interesting. A big promotion for Kwasi Kwarteng. Obviously, he used to be the business secretary. He is now the Chancellor of the Exchequer. So you have to say, I mean, Truss and Kwarteng don't necessarily agree on everything in terms of the Treasury stuff, but they are more closely aligned than I suppose people think they are. But there are some key differences that have been quite obvious even before the leadership election. That you for example, or we'll probably get to it as well. Fracking, for example, was an example I can think of, where Kwasi Kwarteng wrote in, I think it was a post in March, about why it was a bad idea to take out fracking, and then supporting the Prime Minister when it came to removing the moratorium on fracking. He hasn't resigned. Still agrees with it quite well as the Chancellor, so yeah. Jane Cleverly as Foreign Secretary, she's not really surprised, to be fair, was Education Secretary in Johnson's cabinet. I mean, going up to foreign is a big promotion for him. I think it's clear to see that people in number 10 clear. I mean, people pre-prime is to clearly see James Cleverly as a good performer and put in the role. Now, a big promotion, I have to say, is
Suella Braverman. She's now Suella the Home Braverman. Secretary.
She was a leadership contender. Obviously, used to be the Attorney General, has replaced Priti Patel in the role as Home Secretary. So she'll be dealing with illegal immigrants.
So many of them crossing 1,000 in the last week.
Whether she will be able to actually deal with them is one thing. We thought Priti Patel was quite tough on immigrants. Suella Braverman is going to be just as tough, but whether she can actually execute it right is another thing. Nadine Zahari is running the Cabinet Office, so he's pulling the strings behind the civil service and government in many ways. So, yeah, it's a big role for him. A promotion, I would say, for Simon Clark, a Northerner MP, but gets levelling up Secretary Brief. Obviously, he was at the Treasury for some time, but he's now going to the local government's department to be the chief Secretary of State for levelling up. Another big name, and a very big Jolton Johnson name here, Jacob Rees-Mogg. I mean, wow. It's a big role for Jacob Rees-Mogg. He is now the new business secretary, going from a Cabinet Office position to the business secretary. It's a big, big, big promotion for him. I have to say, you could say he's the guy that's running our oil, running the climate change, running our climate crisis. Very interesting enough, in his past views on climate change. Interesting to put him into the role. Kemi Bandaloch, this is a big promotion for her. Some was tipped to try to be in the educational sort of role where she could do a good job doing culture war stuff. Obviously not. She's doing all the trades work instead, striking trade deals between other countries.
A former role Liz Truss used to have.
Yeah, a former role, yeah, absolutely. Before she got promoted to Foreign Secretary. Another big name that you probably never heard of, Chloe Smith, also used to be a Cabinet Office Minister. She has a new role as Work and Pension Secretary, obviously replacing Therese Coffey in that role. But she's been promoted as well. Another Norfolk MP that's very close to Liz Truss in many ways. Alok Sharma remains COP26 president. I mean, I don't know what the point of that role is. Maybe just call it the climate envoy because we've had COP26. We're still going to have COP27 in a few weeks' time. So, yeah, bit of a pointless role. Brandon Lewis is the new Justice Secretary, another Liz Truss supporter and Johnson loyalist who's worked previously in Northern Ireland. He's now running the legal system in the United Kingdom.
Dominic Raab's former position.
He's going to have to sort out a few things as well. Kit Morehouse, the new education secretary. I don't know how many education secretaries we've had in a year now. I think this is the fifth, from what I understand, this year. Fifth education secretary this year. Running out of them, I think, at the moment, Charlie. I think running out of them. New name to the hold. Rani Jawan Genna, I can't pronounce his name correctly, new Environment Secretary. Anne-Marie Trevelyan moves from the trades to transport.
Yeah, Grant Shapps is no longer in the cabinet.
She will be dealing with the strikes, potentially. Mm. She's got to negotiate a settlement between the unions and the rail providers. Chris Heaton-Harris, this is an interesting one, a former ERG chairman. And you just rouse the chief whip. He is the new Northern Ireland secretary. So he's got to deal with the protocol and getting the power sharing agreement going. Interestingly, I want to point something else here. You may not see it on here, but his junior minister in Northern Ireland is former ERG chairman himself, Steve Baker, who's been given the Under Secretary of State role in the Northern Ireland office. So Steve Baker is part of the government now. So that's two former ERG chairs in the Northern Ireland post. Very brave, I have to say, for putting that up in there. Some things don't change. Alistair Jack remains Secretary of State for Scotland. Robert Buckland remains Secretary of State for Wales. Penny Mordaunt has a new role as the leader of the House of Commons. Interesting. Lord True is the leader of the House of Lords. Michelle Donnellan, who used to be a universities minister, is now the culture secretary as well. Mm. So it was revealed this week that she once had previous views in 2019 on abolishing the BBC licence fee. Mm. That'll be interesting to see her when she did get into settlements with the BBC. The new Tory chairman is former Northern Research Group chair, Jake Berry. That's
Minister without a portfolio.
And a new chairman, of the Conservative Party as well. So, yeah, it'll be an interesting role of him. Wendy Morton is the new chief whip. I think it's the first female we've had in that role in terms of chief whip.
Yeah, not the other one. He's gone now.
And a few other ones at Penn Cabinet. Chris Philp, Chief Secretary to the Treasury, used to be Home Office Minister. Michael Ellis, pulling the strings at the Cabinet before, is now the Attorney General, used to be the Solicitor General. Edward Argyll, remember him? Previous Health Minister, he's the Paymaster General. Vicky Ford, MP for Chompford, by the way, is the Minister for Development. Tom Tugendhat, a previous leadership contender, is the Minister for Security. Security Defence Chief in that role now. James Heapley remains his post of Minister for Armed Forces Veteran. And another new one, Minister for Climate, Graeme Stewart, also going to be attending Cabinet as well. So that is the big appointees, Charlie, in the new Liz Truss Cabinet.
Yeah, loads of them. You can't go through enough names just to work out who's in the Cabinet because there's so many of them. And we know that it's a completely different Cabinet to what Boris Johnson. A few people staying, Ben Wallace staying as Defence Secretary. It is going to be very interesting to see how the others get on. Therese Coffey with a big promotion. Two, of course, the Deputy Prime Minister and the former role held by Sajid Javid, Health Secretary. Steve Barclay temporarily, but yeah, it's going to be very, very interesting indeed, to say the least, whether she makes this. This was key moments from Liz Truss's first PMQs with Keir Starmer. Have a listen to this.
I'd also like to take this opportunity to welcome the new Prime Minister to a place.
Why does she think it is that all three female Prime Ministers have been Conservative?
It is quite extraordinary, isn't it, that there doesn't seem to be the ability in the Labour Party to find a female leader, or indeed a leader who doesn't come from North London.
Yeah.
We will be proceeding with the online safety bill. There are some issues that we need to deal with. What I want to make sure is that we protect the under-18s from harm, but we also make sure free speech is allowed. So I'm afraid to say the Right Honourable Gentleman doesn't understand aspiration. He doesn't understand the opportunity.
On her first full day as Prime Minister, she's failed to rule out a trust tax on household and businesses.
But it does have to deliver all of the things we set out in the Northern Ireland Protocol Bill. And what we cannot allow is for this situation to drift.
Thank you there. That was Liz Truss for first PMQs at the dispatch box. I'm sure, Zach, what was your view on it on Wednesday?
Yeah, I have to say, it was a bit different in some ways, but I felt it was different for the better because I feel like we're actually finding out the policy differences between the two parties, between Labour and the opposition, the Conservatives and the opposition, rather than the blustering and personality politics that we seem to have had between Johnson and Starmer. It feels like, you know, in some ways that we actually got to know the policies of each party, and that was a welcome change. That really was a welcome change, rather than it being about the personality and the attack lines and all that sort of thing. Of course, there is the attack lines, but nevertheless, I feel like it was much better in terms of actually distinguishing the two different policies that both parties seem to have as well. But yeah, I think that was a much better in terms of prime minister questions that we previously used to have.
I think it depends on obviously your viewpoint on whether you want a windfall tax on energy companies. I mean, that's another one that Liz Truss and Keir Starmer had a clash on in PMQs. They're going to clash on everything. So the two parties have got different policies. That's what the manifesto plans read. And obviously, Liz Truss takes over after Boris Johnson led Britain through the coronavirus pandemic. Liz Truss has now got to deal with a cost of living crisis, seeing household energy bills soaring, and she's going to try and cut taxes as quickly as possible to get Britain to help families out. And inflation is another thing that it's going to be the government have got to tackle. And also illegal immigration. Can Suella Braverman stop Albanian crime gangs crossing the channel? We'll come back to that later on. Now, I'm going to talk to you guys now about... Actually, let's go on to one more thing about the Russian invasion of Ukraine before we touch on sport news now. With obviously, there'll be no football results this weekend, but we will chat in a minute about some football news regarding managerial departures. I'm going to start off, Zach, with the war in Ukraine. Twitter came to me earlier, a tweet I sent out very, very interesting here. The Putin regime is still clearly committing war crimes today. An electricity supply was hit in one of Ukraine's cities, Kharkiv.
Yeah, the Russians are clearly getting worried now because they hit a new power supply in Kharkiv and certain others. And they have reason to be worried, Charlie, because this week there's been a massive counteroffensive and a fantastic counteroffensive, to be fair, Charlie, by the Ukrainians. A massive, massive counteroffensive in Kharkiv and the Donetsk region as well. It's massive counteroffensive in Kharkiv as well. In Kharkiv, Dnipro, Poltava are areas where the Ukrainians are advancing and taking back territories from the Russians. And I read, if I remember rightly, it was about 3,000 feet square of territory that Ukraine has been taking back from the Russians. That, I believe, if I remember the comparison rightly, is similar to the size of Cambridge. That, and it's big. Cambridge shows big. So the fact they're taking the size of Cambridge shows you how much progress they are making at the moment in terms of counteroffensive as well. So this has been a very bad week for Russia. The last few days have been dreadful. They have been counterattacked in many areas. In Kherson, for example, Ukrainians are making progress there. But in Kharkiv, in Dnipro and Poltava, they're also creating counter attacks there as well. What a week it's been for Ukraine. They've been doing extremely, extremely well as well. They've been doing an incredible job. As well, they've liberated the villages of Vlanchenko and Artemvlika in the Kharkiv region as well. Kupansk as well, and Izium, a very key area that they've potentially going to seize as well very shortly. But it's been a big week for Ukraine, and Russians are getting nervous, no doubt about it. I mean, attacking the power supplies is a mission of defeat in some ways. As well, but it's been a good week for Ukraine, and it's going to get even better, I think, in the next few days with their
I mean, the Russian forces hitting a power, and when the Russian forces clearly like destroying blackout, leading to blackouts in Ukraine. I mean, Jesus, you think that's a war crime because you're hitting electrical infrastructure, and you're like basically hitting all that, and it's causing that to happen. I mean, you don't want to be hitting bits of electrical infrastructure in Ukraine for a start, because it could cause blackouts. We know that for sure. The Russians clearly don't think they're bothered by it, because they think, okay, we can just like basically destroy Ukraine cities and then make them dark. It reminds me of that, as I showed you last week, that as Kiev accuses Moscow of attacking energy infrastructure. So Moscow apparently look like attacking energy infrastructure. It's just causing blackouts. We don't want that to happen. But as I said, Ukraine are fighting back, and Russia telling their people to evacuate Kherson. What? Why say that? Ukraine, Kherson's a Ukrainian city. Come on. They're not Russian, they're Ukrainian. So, yeah, Vladimir Putin will get angrier and he will get madder, I'm sure, in the days ahead. So we've got to keep an eye on what's happening in Ukraine because it's still not over yet. 7 months in already now. Would you believe it? So moving on to sports news now. We're going to touch on the Formula One action first now. In Italy, the Italian Grand Prix at Monza, won today by Max Verstappen, who takes his fifth straight win of the season. Max Verstappen of Red Bull Racing taking his fifth straight win of the season after winning the Italian Grand Prix after a five-place grid penalty for a gearbox change. And Zach, I have to say, Super Max does it again.
Hey, Super Max certainly does it again. Five wins in a row. It just proves how much of a fast car he's having all seats so far in the last couple of races. I mean, Ferrari ran with a good strategy today, but they weren't fast enough. They're not fast enough for the Red Bull. And even on a track that's, you know, is favored towards Red Bull, they're just way too fast for Ferrari. I mean, it could be a little bit more tricky next time in Singapore in 3 weeks' time, but it won't matter soon. Max Verstappen could potentially become the world champion in the next race on based on the scenarios. Here, it may not be possible. He'd have to finish 24 points ahead of Leclerc, basically win the race and Leclerc not score any points, if that's the case. But who's in third, so that may not be possible. But it could be up to Perez, actually. But yeah, it's going to be a case of now when, not if, Max Verstappen gets his second world championship this season. I think it's probably more likely go to Japan to get it, in my view. But it's incredible. He's 114 points ahead. And the job he's done throughout the season, so the last few races, is stunning. I mean, he's just in his element. He's driving in the best car he could possibly get. And he's just done well. Incredible. Leclerc done a good race. Let's just say that. Leclerc did well today. But at the end of the day, once he got to the soft tyres, try to get the strategy right, Red Bulls were too fast. And the soft were lasting longer than what anticipated. We could have got a better race finish today, I think. Obviously, Daniel Ricciardo broke down the end. We didn't get a full finish. It was behind the safety car. But yeah, we could have got a finish. But oh, well. Leclerc was second today. Yeah, as I said, George Russell, good race of him in third.
He was second, wasn't he, last week in Zandvoort, his best result.
Yeah, and George Russell continues good run without. Carlos Sainz was fourth. Have to say, he did all right. Going to the soft tyres helped, I think, a little bit. But obviously got a free pitch stop. But yeah, I thought he did all right today. Hamilton, good progress from back of the pack. He really got caught up in the melee on lap one and had to go, went off the track, got caught up with the traffic jam, but he did a good recovery to fifth. Sergio Perez, sixth, not much he could have really done today. Lando Norris, seventh, could have been a better result for him. He had a poor start, and then was left on the back foot, really. Eighth, Pierre Gasly, and special mention and driver of the day for me, Nick De Vries, who's been standing in for Alex Albon this weekend with a medical problem. Nick De Vries did an incredible job to nearly chase down Pierre Gasly at the end of the race. But the penalties helped, obviously. All the grid penalties on Saturday helped Nick De Vries. But the way he held Guanyu Zhou was incredible for a driver that's only been there in the seat for probably about 3 hours total all weekend long. He did incredible, Nick De Vries. Driver of the day for me, sure. 2 points picked up. Incredible. Well done to him. A fantastic effort on his first Grand Prix for Williams as well. Guanyu Zhou, 10th. Good point for him. Couldn't just catch Nick De Vries, unfortunately. Ocon, 11th. Could have been a better weekend. Mick Schumacher struggled with strategy, 12th. Valtteri Bottas, 13th. Yuki Tsunoda, 14th. Latifi, 15th. Magnussen, again, 16th. Poor race for him. Daniel Ricciardo, DNF'd. Continue the run of drivers who win a race and then crash the following year at Monza or have issues. Daniel Ricciardo, 17th. Lance Stroll was 18th. Also had a problem, mechanical issue there. Alonso broke down 19th, and Vettel also broke down in 20th position as well. So the next race in Singapore is, yes, I say Singapore. That's in 3 weeks' time. We were obviously due to have a race between Monza and Singapore, but obviously that's the Russian Grand Prix, but that obviously got cancelled and terminated because of the war in Ukraine as well. So we're waiting in 3 weeks now until Singapore. And the first return to Singapore since 2019, actually, as well. A race under the lights on the street circuit. It's going to be a very interesting race, Charlie.
Yeah. Before we move on to the other motorsports, Zach, what was your view on the F2 and F3 action with Victor Martins and Felipe Drogovic claiming titles, respectively, in that?
Yeah, well, congratulations to Felipe Drogovic. He's been dominating all season. Very, very congratulations for him. I don't think he'll get a seat next year, but I think he'll get a reserve role somewhere. I don't know whether it'll probably be Alpine. We'll probably give him a reserve role somehow as well. And Victor Martins, it was a bit of a controversial finish, that one, I think, because it finished under red flag. A few incidents, a few types of contenders getting penalties. Victor Martins' win was controversial, but all I can say is well done to him. Congratulations to him as well.
Yeah, so both of them two winning the Formula 2 and Formula 3 championships respectively there. We'll see what happens to them later on. But just to let you know, the Formula 2 winner, I don't think, is eligible for the next season. So I think we'll keep you and I on that news as well. Moving on now to IndyCar. IndyCar currently racing their season finale, I think, today at the Laguna Seca. If I'm correct, with the action from Laguna Seca, because this is actually the final race. Will Power leads the standings. It's been confirmed that, Will Power is on IndyCar pole for that race. Next week, we'll give you the update on the championship. Zach, NASCAR, though, playoff racing this weekend playoff racing, should I say, on right now. But last week, a different winner at Darlington.
Yeah, it was an interesting one at Darlington, Charlie. As well, very, very interesting race. Eric Jones in the 43 was last week's winner after a very great, great finish to the end of the race as well. Eric Jones winning ahead of Denny Hamlin and Tyler Reddick in third position. It was a great race overall. Lots of action as well. Very important win for Eric Jones as well. Obviously, I don't think he's entitled to a playoff. No, he's not in the playoffs, but he managed to win the race. It was a big win for him, a great win as well, and quite a surprising win given the progress he did through the field as well. Denny Hamlin second, Tyler Reddick third, Joe Logano fourth, Christopher Bell fifth, Michael Bardell sixth, Brad Keselowski seventh, William Byron eighth, Bubba Wallace ninth, and Alex Bowman tenth.
The playoff contenders didn't seem to do that well in that race.
No, they didn't, Charlie. No, at all. They didn't. There was a lot of poor results in certain.
And Chase Elliott retired as well.
And Chase Elliott retired as well. But let me tell you the situation actually in the playoffs at the moment after that race, because it is Joe Logano who's the one that's on. None of the playoff contenders actually won so far. So Joe Logano has won ahead on points, ahead of William Byron and Denny Hamlin in third. At the moment, it's tight. There's plenty of opportunities to get in. But I would be a bit worried if I was Daniel Suarez at the moment, or Kyle Busch. Now, Kyle Busch, big news this week, Charlie, from Kyle Busch. He is leaving Joe Gibbs Racing this at the end of the season, Charlie, as well. He's going to join Richard Childress Racing next year. Kyle Busch has been at Joe Gibbs Racing for 15 years. There was a lot of speculation about his contract, what he was going to do, but he's leaving Joe Gibbs Racing at the end of the season. He's going to join Richard Childress from 2023. According to Root reports, the announcement expected Tuesday as well. We don't know what number he will be, but he is going to leave Joe Gibbs Racing on Tuesday announcement on Tuesday he's going to leave Joe Gibbs and go to Rich Chilchester for next season. A big move for Kyle Busch. There are a lot of speculation about his contract, what he's doing. Yeah, it is a big move for Kyle Busch.
It's interesting. Currently, at the moment, we have the Hollywood Casino 400. Martin Truex Jr. leads. Christopher Bell is second. Third is Kyle Busch. William Byron is fourth. Joey Logano complete the top five as well. And we can see the race will currently be updated. A winner will be announced next week on our show. We'll keep you updated with all the highlights. Moving on now quickly to the football. Yes, there was no Premier League this weekend. But that midweek fixtures, plenty of the Champions League, Europa League matches, and another managerial sacking for Chelsea and Thomas Tuchel.
Yeah, this is the shock one of the week. As you know, this weekend, no football matches in honour of Her Majesty the Queen. There's no play this weekend. It may well be that there are probably some matches played next week. I suspect there'll probably be a few postponements, though, because there's going to be all the resources that are going to be needed potentially for the funeral on the Monday after. So there may well be a further set of postponements coming soon. But on the big news of the week prior to that was Chelsea sacking Thomas Tuchel after their 1-0 loss to Dino Zaev on the Tuesday in their Champions League match. It was a very, obviously a surprising loss, no doubt about it. But I thought the sacking was very surprising. And I thought it was a bit premature, personally, in my view, because he's been given a new squad. He signed a load of new players. And it's been two matches since the transfer window has closed. And he's been sacked. And I think it's a bit harsh, in my opinion, because you need with a new squad, you need some time to gel with a new squad, potentially. And, yeah, two games. And sacked with a new squad, I think is a bit, I think it's too early for me. I think it's a bit harsh. Graham Potter, who used to be the Brighton manager, is now the new manager at Chelsea. It's a massive, massive responsibility. Graham Potter's style of play has been praised by quite a lot of pundits and journalists. So it'll be interesting to see how he can translate that into Chelsea and, you know, make their players very useful in some way. So, yeah, big news on there. The football action will continue actually next midweek because there's actually more Champions League and Europa League matches. Obviously, I just want to mention Liverpool losing 4-1 against Napoli on the Wednesday. On the Wednesday. It was a big loss actually for Liverpool. They're a team that are struggling at the moment for whatever reason. They're very much struggling. Manchester United lost to Real Sociedad in the Europa League on Thursday. Spurs got their campaign off with a win on the Wednesday as well. And the Scottish teams both failed to defeat Celtic and Rangers. Celtic lost, I think it was 3-0 against Real Madrid. And it was a hammering for Rangers. 4-1, I believe, it was on the Wednesday as well. Next week, on the Tuesday, this coming up, we've got Sporting v Spurs on Tuesday. Liverpool v Ajax also on Tuesday as well. That's a big match to Liverpool, no doubt. A big, big match to Liverpool. And then on the Wednesday, there's four British teams in action. It'll be Rangers v Napoli on Wednesday. Shakhtar Donetsk v Celtic on the Wednesday. Now, the Rangers game got postponed from Tuesday because of police resourcing issues. So it's going to now be on the Wednesday. Chelsea will take on Salzburg. And Manchester, the big game of the day, of the week, I think, is Manchester City v Dortmund. Erling Haaland is going to be reunited with his old team on Wednesday as well. So, yeah, that's a big match of the week. And in the Europa League, it will be Manchester United will meet Sheriff, who beat Real Madrid in the early stage of the group stage last season. And Arsenal will take on PSV as well on the Thursday as well. So those are the fixtures that are coming up this week in Europe.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. Let's see what the football results bring to the community there for sure. Moving on now to Charlie's good news. And yes, it's good news. I'm actually going away tomorrow to Clacton-on-Sea for a holiday at the Haven, the Orchard. So I thought I'm going away. We'll do a little bit of zero alcohol beer time now. having a look at some of the best 0% beers you can get. Yes, I love drinking these drinks. Trust me, they're not proper alcohol. They're only like 0% alcohol. Well, we'll get Zach's reactions afterwards in some of the brands and some of the products that we might have. I know one of my friends certainly drinks a lot of beer. I'm not going to name it on my show. Right. The first one coming in is Beavertown Laser Crush 0.3 330 millimeters. Our winning low alcohol beer impressed the panel with its tropical fruit aroma. Think ripe mango and pineapple. Apparently, it has well balanced bitterness. Beavertown uses a pilsner base. The beer has a smooth mouthfeel, while the Azica adds a piney freshness, and Citra brings that classic zesty citrus. No, that certainly was a new 5 quid price. Apparently, it's got 0.3 in it. Nothing really to write home about. Brooklyn Berry, that's another one on the list as well. We also have Tiny Rebel CLB. That was another one. Given 73 out of 100, apparently. That's the best low-alcohol tropical IPA. We rolled for that one as well. Keep going down the list. We also have Erdlinger Alcohol Free. We also have the Estrella Zero beer. This is called the Gallica. Estrella do a lot of beers on the tabs in pubs, but this one is their zero version. It goes for the Pilsner-style beer, bring classic toasted malt aromas and light bubbles. Some people felt the flavour was a bit too mild with that, but it is still a decent beer. A lot of people think that that's what Estrella is made for. We also have number 10. I drank this beer the other day. It's actually really nice. I find this very, very strong, really. It's the San Miguel 0.0 alcohol. It's got 330 millimeters. San Miguel's alternative 0% delivers the same initial crisp flavors as well-balanced bitterness, though some felt the finish was relatively short, but I disagree. I actually really liked it as well. Peroni also do the Libera as well, branded with the same Nesso Ledala as the original. That's best lager alcohol-free Italian. That was runner-up for alcohol-free. We've also got Lucky Saint. I had this. That was pretty... I didn't know Lucky Saint had 0.5% in. It's grass beer crisp, citrus flavours right through. It has slightly higher drinking of ABV as well. You can also get some other alcohol-free beers as well. I'm just going to get them up for you right now, guys. You can also have beers such as this one that I'm going to get up for you. This is a Heineken Zero, which is this one in the green glass. Heineken Zeros are available all over the place. I've got a picture of them here. This is Heineken's 0% beer, available in pubs and restaurants. Also available online. If you want to go up to Heineken Zero, you can actually get the price up for one of these because there's plenty of prices for Heineken Zeros. Prices are available on sale. And I think in about, say, let's have a look how much one of them costs. You can probably get one of them in Tesco. Oh, here we go. 0.24, £10.65 for a bottle of 12 in Tesco. £9 for a bottle of 12 there. Heineken Zero. Or you can have what we have a lot. This one. I know a lot of you guys love Birra. Moretti Birra 0% beer. Tesco sell them for, and I quote this now, £4 for four Moretti's, the Birra versions of Moretti's. Here it is, guys, your legendary or pretty famous Moretti Birra served right for you. Many people do have this in the bar. It actually has a very decent, interesting taste. Obviously, Moretti beer is very, very iconic in pubs. A lot of people have it because it's one of the stronger alcohols, and I'm sure plenty of them will be very interesting. Just note on the bottle of the Moretti, it sees a picture of a guy wearing a green suit drinking it. It appears like he's obviously gone and attended some kind of carpentry display up in East London. So, yeah, very interesting indeed. I think it's more of a Victorian image, if you ask me. Zach, what do you make to some of the zero alcohol beers I mentioned?
I mean, they look pretty good. They're quite interesting. Obviously, I'm never going to taste them because I don't drink beer or any alcoholic drinks. So I'm never going to taste them. I don't really want to taste them because given the fact that last time I actually did drink something alcoholic, I was actually very much put off for it for the very first time. So I'll never drink it again. I don't know how much you're going to drink, Charlie, when you go away in Clacton for a few weeks, a few days' time. I'm a bit concerned, actually. Are you suggesting you're going to drink a non-alcoholic beer or something like that?
I don't drink proper alcohol that much.
Fair enough. You're looking at those non-alcoholic beers then. Are you fascinated to see what's on stage there or something like that? Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting, but I thought I'll share a few of them out because I think they're iconic enough and they deserve a bit more in terms of hospitality, needs a bit more support. I mean, all these are available at hospitality, but most people buy them. I've got some in my flat here in the fridge. I've got some Heineken Zeros and I've just realised I haven't drunk any of them yet. So maybe one night I'll have raise a glass to the Queen as well. And I think that would be iconic. So, yeah. Enjoy that. But moving on now, I want to just quickly touch on this before we do the papers. Now, obviously, a lot of these papers tonight will be Raw headlines. I kind of feel like, given that the Queen has passed away, we shouldn't do the newspaper review, but we're going to do it because why not? It's the national newspaper headlines. We should really update. They're all going to be pretty much identical. We're just going to give our own take on what each of them are. So let's go over tomorrow's papers today. And we have literally tomorrow's papers have pretty much come out now. We have several, not just on the funeral, but on other issues as well that we're going to touch on. So we're going to start with Monday's edition of The Guardian saying the Queen begins her final journey as the coffin heads towards through Scotland. Also, Russia launches revenge attacks as Ukraine offensive gathers pace. Also, the Daily Star with the new black background printed on the logo in honour of Her Majesty. Thousands line the street to say goodbye to the Queen. The Daily Telegraph goes with her last great journey and also as well goes with a monologue on the Queen. Headline, her last great journey. The Mirror goes for her final journey home. Financial Times goes, Queen's coffin begins a journey south. King Charles prayers will whistle stop tour of the country, or Britain. Ukraine offensive marks significant gains. Daily Express goes, saddest journey begins. Metro goes with our gracious Queen. Very British headline. Queen's final journey is on the eye. And same goes for the Independent as well. Zach, what do you make to the latest newspaper headlines?
Yeah, not surprisingly, Charlie, they're all royal headlines talking about the Queen. I expect it's going to be, they're all going to be royal based for the next probably week or two or so, whilst we're in this period of mourning. Let's start with The Guardian. Basically, the Queen begins her final journey. So basically, today she was at Balmoral. She did a 6-hour journey from Balmoral to Edinburgh via Aberdeen, Dundee, as well. It was a beautiful journey. It would be routes that she would have really enjoyed going down as well, especially as Queen. She went round, I think, there was a bridge that I think was opened by her. I think it was in a few years ago, actually, as well. So her new Queen's big up themes of fun journey. That's the coffin that is. It's in yellow and red. As well, you can see all the people that are holding it, the flowers at the top. It's yellow, red. It looks like a dragon as well. I think it looks like a dragon on top of the thing as well. The other thing, The Guardian has also mentioned other issues. Obviously, they talk about the Russian launch revenge attacks. You can account offensive gathers pace, as we've mentioned that the Ukrainians have targeted the power. I'm sorry, the Russians have targeted the power supplies and the water supplies as well. Zelensky has said tonight in one of his daily speeches, read my lips, without gas, without you, without light, or without you, without water, or without you, without food, or without you. That is one of the lines of his speech tonight. Zelensky is giving his daily addresses as well of the war. Interesting enough. Daily Star go, which normally a comical headline, has gone for more serious turn. Her final journey, a nation of mourning. And look at that, Co. Look at the amount of people that have gone to the streets to watch. You can just tell what it is, an incredible, what a huge figure that she is, as well. And it's obviously a journey that she would have enjoyed, as well. She would have enjoyed the journey of going up, you know, Aberdeen, Dundee as well. But look at the crowds. They've got, this is a once in a lifetime occasion for most of these people. I mean, 54 years. I mean, like, so this is 70 years. Most people weren't alive by then. And it's going to be like a once in a generation event, rather sadly, that they're not going to see before. Her last journey, the Daily Telegraph goes to saying, the final journey home. This is the final journey home, and her last journey, really, to be fair, as well. Tomorrow she's flying by plane. I think she's getting flown by plane to go to London. I think that's correct in what I'm saying. And then obviously she's then going to be lying in rest at Buckingham Palace for some private family time as well. So the Charles is going to visit the coffin tomorrow in some form, just to grieve privately in Buckingham Palace and in Edinburgh as well. Look, I mean, these are stunning images of all the, I have to say, all credit to all these people who do our duty as well. Financial Times goes with Queen Coughlin's journey south of King Charles prepare for whistle stop tour across Britain. As part obviously of Operation Unicorn, the new king will do a tour of the United Kingdom and go across the nations. So tomorrow, I believe the king will travel to Scotland, obviously to go to Edinburgh. He will visit the Scottish Parliament and give a speech there. In terms of what, then I believe the next day he will then go up to Northern Ireland and visit the Northern Ireland Assembly. He will obviously give a speech there as well. And I believe it's Thursday, he'll go to then Wales and then potentially give a speech in the Welsh Assembly as well. By the way, in terms of what's happened to the other royals, Prince William and Kate have become the new Duke and Prince and Princess of Wales, in case you're wondering, as well. So they've been given promotions by, obviously, Charles, as well. Everyone's moved up across the line, as well. Daily Express, Queen's saddest journey begins. Pretty much as well. You can see all the emotion in there. Queen's final journey begins. Crowd got roadside. 10,000 gathered on the Royal Mile. I mean, that's incredible. Just to see the coffin being sent as well up on the Royal Mile as well. Tomorrow, the King and Queen will lead the procession to St Giles Cathedral, where the coffin is at the moment. Queen will lie in rest there for 24 hours and lie in state Westminster Hall from Wednesday until Sunday, allowing the public. And Charles will begin his first visit to all four nations of the UK. The Metro goes for just our gracious Queen in a very special font as well. And the Independent goes for Queen begin her final journey. Thousands line streets to pay their respects as coffin taken to Edinburgh. Let me tell you this, Charlie. There's going to be millions visiting London in the next few days. Millions of people are going to turn up in London the next few days because they will want to see the Queen's coffin. And the state funeral will see crowds, nothing. The crowds are going to be huge. The crowds are going to be so big, it's going to be nothing like the Platinum Jubilee. It'll probably be the biggest crowd since, I say, Diana's funeral, than I expect the crowds will be in terms of the amount of size. I mean, it's going to be millions of people entering London that day. There's going to be a strain on police resources. But the fact that millions are going to be in London for next Monday, not this Monday, but next Monday, shows you what a treasure the Queen is to everybody. And we know that very big figures are attending. We know the President of the United States is going to be attending. That's one of the confirmed.
Joe Biden
is going to be attending with the First Lady Jill Biden. I expect that we're going to have a lot more figures as well attending the funeral as well. I expect there's going to be a lot more attending as well I expect probably Macron may probably attend.
Not Vladimir Putin.
Not Vladimir Putin. He won't be attending, but sent a wish note of best wishes and thoughts and commiserations. Quite frankly, I can, if I got a note for him giving my thoughts, I'd bloody rip it up and put in the bin, quite frankly, if that was me, knowing him as well. But yeah, there's going to be loads of people attending as well. There's going to be so much going on. And that was the pretty much the similar papers for today, Charlie.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting as well. We also have confirmed as well the masked dancer was revealed to people on their headline the other week. Usually we get the headlines of the masked dancer seeing people being revealed. Jesse Metcalf got revealed last week. He was astronaut yesterday. We had another unmasking. Zach, do you want to tell the listeners who have not
I'm going to try and get it up now, actually, because I didn't actually watch it on Saturday. Obviously, I was focusing on the Queens and the news. But the pig was eliminated. It was Gavin and Stacey's star, Joanna Page, was a pig, was the one that was eliminated on the show on Saturday. That was still shown as normal, by the way. Because I see we return to a sort of normal schedule for tomorrow, for the weekend on the Saturday. Obviously, news dominated, but there's some of the shows still going on. We know that the British Bake Off is still going ahead as scheduled on the Tuesday. We don't know whether Strictly is going to go ahead next week. We'll have to find out during the week. But yeah, some shows will be returning to normal services this week. Obviously, it's been sort of been overlooked because of the news this week, the momentous news of the Queen's death. But yeah, we know that pig that got eliminated was Joanna Page.
Joanna Page was pig, yeah. More coming out. Tomato sauce, Pickett and Post. That'll be my interesting one. Who is Pickett and Post? The first double act on a competition.
Oh, I want to know as well. Yeah, it'll be interesting.
Joel Dommett. I'm guessing Marvin Humes and Rochelle. Maybe Humes potentially. Jamie thinks in the man to hold of Mark Breakfast. We don't know, but that's all I'm going to say as well. And also, you can have a look at the local news headlines. To the Queen. Oh, I did just pick myself off the stream there by the sound of it. A local news update, probably all royal themed again as well. Essex will prepares to come together for the proclamation of the King. As well, we also have as well more other news just in general, which is important. I also want to just quickly touch on an Essex crime scene news as well, which was here, because this is very, very important that I'm just going to announce before we do the Great British Star and Red Devil. A horrible event happened. Basildon mum's fears after an incident down Wickford Avenue. Oh, no, that's actually very close to where I used to live. A worried mum fears gangs of youths are targeting young cyclists in Basildon and claims her son's a victim of attempted robbery. Walking home from school, the 14-year-old boy was reported to have threatened by two teenagers who demanded money from him. They then damaged the boy's bike and then stole dust caps before fleeing the scene. The victim's mum said he was not harmed during the incident, which happened around 3 p.m. at Wickford Avenue on Wednesday. However, he was left badly shaken. He's out unable to use his bike. Because it's damaged badly. Zach, what do you make to this news story?
Yeah, it's a pretty grim story that came out on Wickford Avenue, actually. Very grim as well. And I just hope that the cyclists are okay. Most folks, thanks to this robbery, I hope that everyone's okay. Hopefully, whoever's caused the crimes are going to get locked up.
Yeah, local news indeed is what we'll still be covering on the show every week, and we will get your thoughts on that. But yeah, horrible event. It seems like young people are really getting targeted by crimes. We're looking at London as an example of that. So that's clear to me exactly what's happening. Now, time now to do the Great British Stars and Red Devils of the week. We're going to start off with the nominations for the Great British Star. My nominations are, well, the star is going to definitely be Queen Elizabeth II. I can't say enough what incredible commitment she's done to our country, serving our monarch for the last 70 years. You've got to give her due credit for that. She did die, unfortunately, died peacefully at Balmoral on Thursday. Also, another nomination. The Great British Star gets another nomination this week. because I'm also going to give it to this person. I'm going to give it to His Royal Highness King Charles III, who is now going to be the new King of England. That's my other nomination. On that, Red Devils this week, Vladimir Putin for shutting Europe's gas supplies off as well, but also to an animal rights group. Now, have you heard of the animal rights group this week? It is very much aimed at this protest in a shop in London spilling milk. It is not easy. Well, it's actually, I don't know what to say other than a spilling milk protest. It's called illegal milk protest, if you want to ask me. I don't know. Well, it's basically a group. Okay, it's an animal rebellion group. I just quickly go over this here. Basically, I saw a video the other day of it was a video. I forgot where it was, but they spilled milk on the floor.
I see you showing me the other night. Yeah,
and
deliberately.
I want to say, it was in a supermarket, I think, in London or somewhere. And I have to say, I don't know what the group is called, but it is absolutely ridiculous. I mean, what the hell? Look at this. I mean, this was revealed. This was on Instagram the other week. I mean, what the? I mean, look. Seriously, this was it was in a Harrods department store. What is the name of the group? For a start, is it called Animal Rebellion or Petter?
Animal Rebellion. I think it's Animal Rebellion.
It's an Animal Rebellion group. Well, it's not Petter because they're another animal rights.
Yeah, they're another.
But this is the scene. I cannot believe that this was the other month. I mean, and I saw the video the other day and it went viral on the internet. I mean, Zach, what do you make to this?
I know they want us all to become vegan, for heaven's sake, but gosh. That's pretty bad. I can understand their causes, but please don't shove veganism down our throats. Thank you very much. If I'm going to be vegan, I'll choose to be vegan. I would have to shove milk down onto the floor to be vegan. I'm vegetarian anyway. I'm happy to be. I think going vegan will be too far, in my opinion.
Here we go, guys. I just want to quickly. This is the new image we're going to get up for you now. I found this new one that come up. Animal Rebellion vegans have emptied shelves in a North London supermarket, blocking dairy distribution sites. That was in Hatfield on Thursday. Oh my god. I don't know what to say about this. Look, I mean, is that entirely true? M&S, where I work, imagine them emptying on milk shelves. We'll be pretty livid with that, I think.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Look, there's not much left of that milk. You have to say as well, they've all been taken and ruined, and that's just mad, isn't it? That's absolutely mad.
Go on, Zach, your nominations at the Star and the Red Devil.
Yeah, week. Let's get rid of it. Obviously the British Stars, obviously I'm gonna go with all your choices, to be fair, Charlie. The Queen, for all her services she's done to our country. Charles for stepping up. He really has stepped up and all that sort of thing. As well, and he's done a great job stepping up as well, and Ukraine for you know, it's been sort of out, not really overlooked, really, to be fair, but incredible job of the counter-offensive that they've done to liberate some areas as well. The Red Devil's gonna be an interesting one. I've not really thought much of this until today, actually. I'm gonna give it to the I can't believe I'm actually saying this now, but I'm gonna give this week's one to the police in, I think it's in Edinburgh, actually. Now, you don't have to agree with this to know that this is a little bit risky. So we go on about free speech and everything, and that's very important. Today in Edinburgh, a woman was arrested for holding a sign that said, F imperialism, abolish monarchy. she got, now, I have to say something. I don't agree with those views whatsoever. I don't agree. Let me just make it clear. I don't agree with her views on that. But the thing about it is that she has the right to hold those views if she wanted to. We don't have to agree with it. I don't agree with it. But she has the right to hold that views and hold a sign like that. She got arrested simply for holding that sign today, for showing that sign. I think it was ill-timed and a bit crass, personally. I think it's inappropriate this time. But the fact that she's a sign of free speech and she's got arrested for basically holding that sign, the police claimed it was a breach of the peace. Don't know what else she was doing, but I thought it was ridiculous, quite frankly, and an overreach of police powers that she'd been arrested for a sign that says, F imperialism, abolish the monarchy. I don't agree with the message at all, but I don't agree with the idea of being arrested for saying it. So that policeman in Edinburgh becomes the Red Devil this week, Charlie.
I didn't even know they'd done that. Well, free speech is important unless you agree with the monarchy, unless your name is not Meghan Markle. So yeah. I think you could all assume that. But yeah, no, I think the Red Devil this week, for me, has to be Vladimir Putin.
This is the person that got arrested, by the way. This is someone called Simon Hill. I was arrested today in another one that got arrested. I was arrested today in Oxford after I voiced my opposition to proclaim that Charles III. Can we be arrested simply for expressing opinion in public? I was arrested under the police bill passed earlier this year. This is an outrageous assault on democracy. Hashtag not my king. Yeah, another one got arrested today. I think it's a bit of an overreach of police power for arresting those with different opinions. I do have to say that. So, yeah, I don't agree with the message, but I don't agree with arresting them. That's all I'm going to say on that.
It's an interesting one. That's all I can say.
Yeah.
Yeah. All I can say, guys, is whatever you want to do, free speech is important. We must promote that immediately. But all I can say, guys, the end of the show tonight. Thank you so much for watching this extended coverage of the Charlie Tolhurst Show, focusing heavily on the Majesty, the Queen. Our thoughts are with the Queen right now, and we will be continuing with the coverage of the Royal News next week, and also keeping you and I as well with all the latest news. There'll be more videos launching next week, also on my YouTube channel, which you'll be able to watch, including plenty of other content that's going to be coming up as well. The Charlie Tolhurst Show returns next weekend with a preview to the Queen's funeral at Westminster Abbey. And thank you for watching, everyone. Take care and good night.